We try to have the little ones come up so that way you have something nice to look at while you're listening to us, all right? Remember, though, that song, I started thinking about it as we were singing it. Remember, it says that Jesus was sleeping, not that the church members were sleeping. So hopefully for the next 20, 25 minutes, you'll stay awake for me and get something out of the Word of God this morning. Back in 3 John, verse number 4, I have no greater joy than to hear that my children walk in truth. Just a few more weeks of this theme, walking in truth. And remember, once again, as we think about this theme and think about this phrase, walking in truth, what John here was referring to was how that the lives of these first century Christians lined up with the Word of God. Walking was a way that he illustrated their living, their lifestyle, and the truth. Remember, Jesus said, "Thy word is truth." So when John said that he had great joy because he heard that his children, these Christians, walked in truth, he was saying, I have great joy because I hear that your lives line up with God's word, that you are living according to God's word. Turn now with me, if you would, over to Luke chapter number 1. Luke chapter number 1, last week we looked here in Luke chapter number 1. And if you would, look with me here at verse number 26. Luke chapter number 1 and verse number 26, we talked last week about walking to Nazareth. Walking to Nazareth. Because here in the city of Nazareth, we find a young lady by the name of Mary. And the Bible says here in verse number 26, and in the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God unto a city of Galilee named Nazareth to a virgin espoused to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David, and the virgin's name was Mary. And the angel came in unto her and said, Hail, thou that art highly favored, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women. And when she saw him, she was troubled at his saying, and cast in her mind what manner of salutation this should be. And the angel said unto her, Fear not, Mary, for thou hast found favor with God. And behold, thou shalt conceive in thy womb, and bring forth a son, and shalt call his name Jesus. He shall be great, and shall be called the Son of the Highest. And the Lord God shall give unto him the throne of his father David, and he shall reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end. Then said Mary unto the angel, How shall this be, seeing I know not a man? And the angel answered and said unto her, The Holy Ghost shall come upon thee, and the power of the Highest shall overshadow thee. Therefore also that holy thing which shall be born of thee shall be called the Son of God. And behold, thy cousin Elizabeth, she hath also conceived a son in her old age, and this is the sixth month with her, who is called barren. For with God nothing shall be impossible. And Mary said, Behold, the handmaid of the Lord, be it unto me according to thy word. And the angel departed from her. And remember, last Sunday morning we talked about walking to Nazareth because this young lady Mary, as we just read in these verses, was visited by Gabriel, the angel of God. And after this visit, she walked from Nazareth to this hill country. a country that was located in the region known as Judea. And on a Bible map, if you were to look for the city of Nazareth, you would find it west of the Sea of Galilee, and it was in the region known as Galilee. And she had to travel through the region of Samaria to get to this region, Judea, where her cousin Elizabeth lived. And as she walked to Elizabeth's home, or as she made her way to Elizabeth's home, she kept thinking to herself, is what I just heard real? Is what I just saw real? Was this really an angel of God that visited me? And does God really want to do something special with me and great through me? Remember, as soon as she entered into Elizabeth's home, the Bible says in verse number 41, and it came to pass that when Elizabeth heard the salutation of Mary, the babe leaped in her womb. This is Elizabeth's baby, John the Baptist. And Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Ghost, and she spake out with a loud voice and said, blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb. And whence is this to me that the mother of my Lord should come to me? As soon as she entered the home of her cousin Elizabeth, the Holy Spirit used Elizabeth to confirm that the visit of the angel was real, to reaffirm Mary's faith that God wanted to do something great with her and through her. And so then we find in verse number 56, and Mary abode with her about 3 months and returned to her own house. She walked back to Nazareth. And she walked back to Nazareth differently than she walked to Judea, differently than she walked to Elizabeth's house, because now she's walking back with confidence that God wants to use her and that God can use her. She's not walking back with her head lifted high in a way of arrogance or pride. Remember, this was a humble lady. She was walking back just being assured that God knew who she was and wanted to use her. And we said last Sunday morning that God wants to use each and every one of us. He knows your name this morning. The Bible says, and Jesus said when he was on the earth, that God knows the very numbers of hair on your, or the very number of hairs on your head. As we said before, many of us men have a few less today, so it's probably easier for God to count our hairs than when we were younger. But nonetheless, God knows who you are. And God wants to do something great with you, and he wants to do something great through you. But it's going to require that you live the way that Mary did, that you have faith like she had, that you have humility like she had, that you surrender yourself to God and say, God, I'll do what you want me to do. Remember that last phrase in verse number 38 that she shared with the angel, behold, the handmaid of the Lord. Remember, a handmaid was a servant. She says, behold, the servant of the Lord, the handmaid of the Lord. She surrendered her will. She gave control over to God and said, God, whatever you want to do with me, through me, may your will be done. You take my abilities, whatever they might be, and you use them for your honor and glory. And that's what we talked about last Sunday morning. Now I want to talk about walking to Bethlehem. Turn over to Matthew chapter number 1. As we now turn our attention to Joseph. Matthew chapter number 1 and verse number 18. Matthew chapter number 1 and verse number 18. The Bible says here, now the birth of Jesus Christ was on this wise. When as his mother Mary was espoused to Joseph, before they came together, she was found with child of the Holy Ghost. Then Joseph, her husband, being a just man and not willing to make her a public example, was minded to put her away privily. But while he thought on these things, behold, the angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a dream, saying, Joseph, thou son of David, fear not to take unto thee Mary thy wife, for that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Ghost. And she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus. For he shall save his people from their sins. Now all this was done that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken of the Lord by the prophet, saying, behold, a virgin shall be with child, and shall bring forth a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which being interpreted is God with us. Then Joseph, being raised from sleep, did as the angel of the Lord had bidden him, and took unto him his wife, and knew her not till she had brought forth her firstborn son, and he called his name Jesus. The Bible here tells us about this man, Joseph. And so often, when we think about the Christmas story, the Nativity, we think about Joseph and Mary. But when you think about Christianity in general, So much emphasis is put on Mary alone, because Mary is the one who gave birth, obviously, to the Lord Jesus Christ. Because Mary is mentioned later on in the scriptures. Because Mary is the one who's standing at the foot of the cross when Jesus is hanging on it. And so for that reason, Joseph a lot of times gets lost in the scene. He gets forgotten, I believe, in Christianity. And this morning, I want us to look at him for a moment. And I want us to think about this, that without Joseph, there would be no Mary. Without Joseph, there would be no Mary. Remember, Mary was a virgin at this time in Luke chapter number 2 when the angel came to her. And she was fulfilling a scripture that the Bible tells us here in verse number 23, behold, a virgin shall be with child. If there had not been a Joseph, and Mary had experienced what Luke chapter number 2 told us, or Luke chapter number 1, excuse me, told us she would, which was God coming upon her and filling her with the Holy Spirit of God and the Son of God being born of her, she would have been looked at as a harlot. She would have been despised in her community had there been no Joseph. Joseph served an important role. And this morning, maybe you look at your life and you don't see yourself as a Mary. You don't see yourself as someone God can do something great with. Let me tell you, let me reaffirm what I said just a few moments ago. God does know you. God does want to do something great with you, and he does want to do something great through you. But he doesn't want you just to be like Mary. He also wants you to be like Joseph. Why? Because there's a Mary out there that you need to help today. God wants to use you and do something great through you, but he also wants you to be a help to someone. And he wants to use you to be a help to that person, to help them reach their potential, ultimately. Joseph was used by God to help Mary reach her potential. Once again, remember when God is looking down from heaven and he's looking way back at the beginning of creation, because God sees everything like a timeline from creation till the end. He sees it all. And at the beginning of time, he's looking down through the annals of time, and he sees that his son is going to have to come and be born of a virgin. He doesn't just go eeny, meeny, miny, mo to pick out who he's going to have bear this child. He knows that it's going to be Mary, and he knows that it's going to be Mary for the characteristics that she had that we talked about last week. At the same time, he knows that Joseph is necessary. And he once again doesn't just pull a name out of a hat and say, oh, I guess Joseph is the winner. No, he looks and he says, here's a man that I know I can trust with this responsibility to help Mary become what I want her to become, for Mary to be used by me. There needs to be this young man, Joseph. And he looks at the characteristics that Joseph has. If you want God not only to do something great through you, but you want God to use you to be a help to someone else, then you need to try to follow in the example of Joseph. Let's look at three characteristics he had real quickly this morning. First off, we see here, the Bible says in verse number 18, now the birth of Jesus Christ was on this wise. When as his mother Mary was espoused to Joseph before they came together, she was found with child of the Holy Ghost. So we see that this passage is being recorded, and it's taking place after Luke chapter number 1. But it's taking place before Luke chapter number 2. Luke chapter number 2 is where Jesus is actually born. Luke chapter number 1 is where we just read. Gabriel visits Mary. Mary visits Elizabeth. And then Mary returns home. Here we're told that now she knows that this is of God. She returns home. She is 3 months pregnant at this time. And she returns home and she shares this news with Joseph. Could you imagine being Joseph this morning? You've been gone for 3 months, Mary. You come back and you tell me you're 3 months pregnant, and this is supposed to be the Holy Ghost that came and did this work in you. Now, in the 21st century, obviously, we know exactly where that story would be taken and how she'd be run through the mud. We know she'd probably end up on some type of television show, and her name would become synonymous with some of those who have obviously flaunted their indiscretions on TV before. And so here's Joseph getting this news. You're pregnant. We're espoused. We're betrothed. We're supposed to get married. But I have not been with you. We have been pure in our relationship. And you're telling me that you've been faithful to me. this is the situation he finds himself in. This takes a special man to stay with Mary and to help her become what God wants her to be, the mother of Jesus Christ. Verse number 19. Here's the characteristics starting here in verse number 19. Then Joseph, her husband, being a just man. We see first off his character. He was a man of character. We're told here, then Joseph, her husband, being a just man. Now you notice how that title was used, husband, for him. Because she was promised to him. They were engaged. And that during that engagement, she was considered his wife, and he was considered her husband. This man was a just man. There is not much of a, or there's not a better title you could have asked as a woman for your husband to have than for him to be called just. In the Old Testament, Noah, in Genesis chapter number 6, is referred to as a just man. Characteristics of a just man are given to us in the Old Testament, but that phrase itself is associated with just a few people in the Bible. Noah is one. John the Baptist is another. Jesus is a third. In fact, when Jesus was there on trial, Pilate's wife had a bad dream, you may remember, and she sent a messenger to Pilate, the governor, and told him, have nothing to do with this just man. Joseph is up there with a group of men that are like none other. Noah, who lived by faith. John the Baptist, who preached the word of God without compromise. And Jesus, who was the only one to ever live a life of righteousness and perfection on this earth. That's who Joseph is with, or what category he falls into. A just man. If we want God to use us to help other people reach their potential, then we have to be people of character. We have to live on principles, not emotions. Emotions we all have. And emotions many times govern our reactions to situations. You know, I've mentioned before, my dad's a carpenter, and I learned a lot from my dad. And we built 3 homes when I was a young person. We built a home, lived in it for some time, built another home, lived in it, built another home, lived in it. Then when my wife and I, after we got married, my parents decided to build another home, so we helped with that one as well a little bit. And I learned a lot from my dad, but I'm not a carpenter. He's the carpenter. I was more of the gopher. I went and got what he wanted me to get him. And I learned as I was watching him and as he taught me things here and there. But I could not do half of what my dad can do when it comes to carpentry. And so when we were in Ukraine and we'd have a problem, Brother Wagner, with our house over there, I had no concerns. Because number one, I was renting. And number two, they fix everything with hammer and nails. So I can fix everything with hammer and nails. Here in the United States, however, and in California, in Atwater, we now own our own home. So it's a little bit different. No landlord to call. Hammer and nails doesn't fix everything, at least not if you want it to last a long time. And so the other day we got that rain, and we got, I think it was on Monday or Tuesday, somewhere around there, and we were moving things around because we were trying to figure out where to put the Christmas tree in the house. And so we were moving it. We moved one of the couches, and we noticed water on the ground. And we started looking up, and sure enough, there was a leak up towards the ceiling a little bit. And I immediately started getting worried. Oh, man, I'm going to need a new roof on the house. What are we going to do? This is all going on inside me. But I try to stay composed. I try to remain reserved, you know. But inside, I'm going, oh, man, this is thousands of dollars. I'm in trouble. So what do? I pick up the phone and I call the carpenter I know, my dad. I said, Dad, I think I got a leak in the roof. What do I do? And he tells me what to do. And I go through the things he tells me to do and I do them. I called another preacher that I know who's a carpenter as well here in Atwater, and he called me back. He was in Kentucky. He said, you know what? He goes, you got a great roof on your house. He goes, it showed me the roof. It's probably this. So then I called my dad back, tell him what that preacher said. He goes, you know what? He's probably right. When it was all said and done, it cost me $4.50 for a tube of caulk. Amen. But at the time, I was emotional inside. I was an emotional wreck. But I don't want my wife and my kids who think I'm Superman to see their dad break down crying because the roof's leaking. So I keep my composure. We're all emotional at times, but we can't live based off emotion. We have to live based off of principle. Emotions go up and down. Principles stay the same. Joseph was a just man. He was a principled man. He was a moral man. Second characteristic we see about him here in verse number 19. It says, then Joseph, her husband, being a just man and not willing to make her a public example, was minded to put her away privily. We see his compassion. He was not only a man of character, he was a man of compassion. Here we're told that he was not willing to make her a public example. He didn't want to make a spectacle of Mary. Once again, she comes back from her cousin's home, 3 months away. She tells him, I'm pregnant, but this is of the Holy Ghost. This is of God. He then has a decision to make. What am I going to do about this? Because this is not my child. Hold your place here, if you would, and turn back to Deuteronomy chapter number 24. I want you to see what the law at Joseph's time said concerning his situation, what his option was or his options were. In Deuteronomy chapter number 24, in verse number 1, God gave this instruction to Moses to give to the children of Israel, and they kept it as their law. In Deuteronomy 24, 1, the Bible says, when a man hath taken a wife and married her, and it come to pass that she find no favor in his eyes because he hath found some uncleanness in her, then let him write her a bill of divorcement and give it in her hand and send her out of his house. And when she is departed out of his house, she may go and be another man's wife. And if the latter husband hate her and write her a bill of divorcement and giveth it in her hand and sendeth her out of his house, or if the latter husband die, which took her to be his wife, her former husband, which sent her away, may not take her again to be his wife after that she is defiled. For that is abomination before the Lord. And thou shalt not cause the land to sin, which the Lord thy God giveth thee for an inheritance. Now, here in these four verses, the Lord was not giving his stamp of approval to divorces. We know it in the 21st century. People nowadays divorce over everything. And that's not what God was saying here. Here in verses 1 through 4, when he says that if a man marries a woman and then she has no favor in his eyes because he hath found some uncleanness in her, what he means is not necessarily adultery, but there's some issue that they have that can't be overcome. He says, then he can write her a bill of divorcement. This was a public document that he would write, and it would relieve her of that marriage that they had. And she could take that document and she could then marry someone else. But he said in verse number 4, verses 3 and 4, that if her second husband died, or maybe they divorced, she could never be remarried to her first husband. The reason why the Lord said this was because he wanted them to stop and think about that divorce before they did it. He didn't want them just to say, oh, you left that lid off the toothpaste. I'm divorcing you. You keep leaving that toilet seat up. It's over for us, buddy. No, God didn't want that. Marriage is a sacred institution. And God wanted the Israelites to take time and to think before you act off emotion. Think about what you're doing. So with that said, back in Matthew chapter number 1, we see what Joseph's options were. He could stay with her, or he could write her a bill of divorcement and send her on her way. Because this was an issue of uncleanness. This was not his child. She's saying this is nobody else's child. She's saying this is of God. But we see his compassion here. Why? Because it says that he was not willing to make her a public example. That doesn't mean that he was going to make a spectacle of her, but that everyone would know if he gave her a writing of divorcement, everyone would know Joseph divorced Mary because she has an illegitimate child inside her. And he was not willing to make a public example of her. Why? He had compassion. He had charity. He had love for her. And so he didn't want to make a spectacle of her. In fact, in verse number 19, it says that he was not willing to make a public example of her. And it says was minded to put her away privily. What does that mean? On that bill of divorcement that would be given, he could write for what reason, or he was supposed to write for what reason he was divorcing her. Joseph was thinking to himself, Mary's pregnant. This is not my child. I love her. And I don't want people to mock her. I don't want people to ridicule her or be cruel to her. But I'm tempted to go ahead and divorce her. If I divorce her, I'm going to leave that line blank. Why am I divorcing her? It's confidential. Nobody needs to know. It's between her and I. He was compassionate. He wasn't vindictive. He wasn't prideful. He wasn't jealous. He wasn't envious. He was compassionate. If you want God to use you to help other people reach their potential, you have to be a person of character. You have to be a person of compassion. Sometimes people that are people of compassion get stepped on. Sometimes you get hurt, but you have to continue to be compassionate. The third thing we see here in verse number 20, but while he thought on these things, behold, the angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a dream, saying, Joseph, thou son of David, fear not to take unto thee Mary, thy wife, for that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Ghost. He gets visited by the angel of the Lord and told, hey, what Mary told you, it's true. That is of God. And he goes on in verse number 21, the angel does and says, and she shall bring forth a son and shall call his name Jesus. And thou shalt call his name Jesus. For he shall save his people from their sins. Now all this was done that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken of the Lord by the prophet, saying, behold, a virgin shall be with child and shall bring forth a son. And they shall call his name Emmanuel, which being interpreted is God with us. And here we see the third characteristic in verses 24 and 25. Then Joseph, being raised from sleep, did as the angel of the Lord had bidden him, and took unto him his wife, and knew her not till she had brought forth her firstborn son, and he called his name Jesus. He was committed. He was committed. He was committed to Mary, and he was committed to God. The angel came and told him, hey, she told you the truth, Joseph. This baby is of God. And Joseph, this baby is going to be born. This baby is the Son of God, and you need to call him by the name Jesus. You need to understand that all that's going on in her life is a result of God working in her and through her, and you need to help her. And Joseph wakes up, and he has a decision once again to make. What do I do? With it now being affirmed in his heart and his mind, this is of God, he makes the decision that he's going to keep her as his wife and not write a bill of divorcement, not put her away privily, but to keep her. And not only that, not to be close to her, not to have an intimate relationship with her till after this child has been born. Why? Because he wants to make sure that everybody knows this child is special. And that no one can ever say that that this was a result of him and Mary being unfaithful to that marriage commitment before they got married. And then at the end of verse number 25, it says, and he called his name Jesus. Now think about it. When the baby was born, the father was given the responsibility of naming the child. In the story of John the Baptist, Zechariah, remember, lost his ability to speak. And so Elizabeth, Mary's cousin, when she gave birth to that child, everybody said, what are you going to name him? What are you going to name him? And John writes down John, or Zacharias writes down John. And everybody says, well, what are you, John? You don't have any family that's named John. And then God gave him the ability to speak. And he says, hey, this is what I've written. This is what his name's going to be. The father had the ability to say what the child was going to be named at that time. And Joseph had that temptation. He could name that child anything he wanted. He could have named him Jacob. He could have named him Joseph after himself. He could have named him Israel. He could have named him whatever he wanted. But the angel had told him 6 months earlier, when Mary was 3 months pregnant, you need to name him Jesus. And so what does he do? He says, his name's Jesus. He was committed to Mary. And so he stayed in that relationship, but he was committed to God as well. And he says, God, I will honor what your messenger told me. I will do what the angel told me, and I will name him Jesus. If we want to see God use us to help others reach their potential, we have to be committed to the cause of Christ. We have to be committed to God Almighty if we want to see him use us in a great and mighty way. As we close this morning, let me say this. That Joseph, even though he gets lost, as I said, in the Gospels, and people forget about him so often, remember this. Jesus, at the age of 30, starts his ministry. And he's back in Nazareth. And remember, he's in the synagogue. And the people hear him speak. And remember, Jesus spoke like no one else that had ever spoken before. And they ask this question, is not this Joseph? Joseph's son, the carpenter's son. They didn't say, is not this Mary's son? They said, is not this Joseph's son? Why? Because Joseph was honored by God. for his faithfulness to do what God told him to do. He was called, Jesus was called the son of Joseph when he started his ministry. What an honor that was for him. Joseph wasn't seeking attention. He wasn't seeking notoriety. He wasn't seeking praise. He was just doing what God wanted him to do. And if you're going to be used by God to help others out, you can't be seeking the limelight. You can't expect people to lift you up and praise you. You just have to stay back behind them and keep encouraging them. Keep pushing them forward like we do as parents with our kids. We want our kids to do better than we've done. We want them to succeed more than we've succeeded. And we continue to push them and guide them and direct them. If you want to help others reach their potential, that's what you're going to have to do. And you're going to have these characteristics like Joseph if you want God to use you. Walking to Bethlehem. Let's pray. Father, thank you for all that you've done for us. Thank you for all that you've given to us. Lord, I pray that you'd help us to take what we've heard this morning and apply it to our